Have you watched the videos?
No.
Well, apparently we're going to be working on a problem that requires the use of a structural analysis software. Dr. Batts posted a video late last night explaining how to work the problem.
No, what is that?
All right, everyone, welcome to class. Go ahead and open up the software on your computers. We're going to be using it today to learn the direct analysis method. Now, I'm sure you guys are very familiar with the software as we were using it all last semester. So go ahead, pull it up, and get ready to go. So today, we're going to go through the five things of the direct analysis method.
What in the world is a direct analysis method? How on earth?
So today, we're going to cover the five criteria for the direct analysis method. And we can find this in AISC Chapter C. So the first criteria is that all flexural, shear, axial, and all other deformations must be included in your analysis.
Okay, so direct analysis method, five criteria. Axial force, shear.
Okay, and that's it. Only five simple criteria to solve using the direct analysis method. Now to get started, I'm gonna let you guys work in groups in our analysis software. Even though I know you are experts from the 6 to 8 hours you used this last semester, and you know, of course, from that 10-minute video that I posted late last night. And I'll even help you get started, all right? So go ahead and open up the software, and we're going to get a node in at coordinate 0, 0, 0.
So I define node 0, 0, 0, submit. Let's see what's next.
And so we're done. Pretty easy, right? Is anyone having trouble keeping up? Well, let's go ahead and run a second order nonlinear analysis then. And there we have it. Looks like we finished just in time.
But we didn't do part 2, or 3.
Or 1 for that matter.
Please come to class Thursday with the difference between a first order and second order analysis clearly defined, as this will be on the exam. And oh yeah, and just wrap up the assignment from today and turn that into, that'll be great. Good luck, we'll see you later.
Bro, that was easy. The second order analysis had way higher bending moments and deflections than the first one.
Really? When I ran the analysis a second time, I got the same answer.
That's because you ran the same type of analysis. When engineers talk about using a second order analysis, they're talking about using the effects of both P little delta and P big delta. Do you see item B?
Yeah, so it says perform equilibrium on the deformed structure, but I really don't know what that means.
So basically it means that instead of applying 100% of the loads at once, we're going to apply in increments. Say like 5%, do the analysis, get the bending moments and deflections, then add another 5% to that deformed structure and repeat till we get to 100%. When the building is deformed, the members are going to pick up additional moments due to the P big delta effect.
And what about the P little delta, though?
It's the same thing, but on the member level. Since we subdivided each of our members, we're better capturing the bend geometry of the member as the load is applied in increments, thus accounting for the P little delta effect.
Oh, I see. So that's the reason why we modeled all the columns with an L over 500 out of plumbness, to account for additional moments and deformations due to geometric imperfections in the system.
Exactly. Item C requires us to account for imperfections. If you didn't want to give your initial column loads a slanted geometry, you could just model it perfectly straight and just add the notional loads per AISC Chapter 2.2. The member imperfections will be included since we select member designs using the AISC column curve in Chapter E.
See, I get that, but I'm really stuck on items A and D. Did you really do that?
Yeah, man. Item A is pretty easy. Pretty much any commercially available software will calculate the flexural, shear, and axial deformations needed to solve for the displacement in the structure. As long as you don't have a funky or flimsy connection, you should be fine.
And item D was handled when we used 0.8 times the modulus of elasticity in the program.
Now you're getting it. In addition to 0.8E, we also need to include the tau factor. We could use this tau factor directly given to us in Chapter 2.3, or we can include an additional notional load. Or, like we did in class, we ran our analysis with a nonlinear material option that automatically reduced the stiffness as we got closer to FY.
Okay, so it seems like we got A through D, but did we get E?
Yeah, since we're using the LRFD, we're accounting for uncertainty. That was like day one in class, bro.
Am I supposed to remember that?
You know, maybe I understand now.